Hello and welcome to the Football Friends podcast for another week. I'm your host Gage. I'm joined by Paddy and Ash today.
Hello.
Kia ora.
I suppose I'm not the host. We're co-hosts, aren't we? I just haven't figured out the way to be like, hey, I'm Gage.
Well, you are the host in that we are guests in your
dungeon
room. Yeah, I wanted to call it a room, but it's a... it's a cave of...
it's the incel cave.
It's a cave of impropriety.
Yeah.
It's a closet of must and Red Bull.
Mainly Red Bull.
Yeah, all right. Well, we'll stop picking apart my room and we'll move on to some football, all right?
Yes, host.
All right. So do we want some brief praise for Aston Villa specifically?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm thoroughly impressed with their transfer action so far.
Yeah, big money moves for little old Aston Villa. So,
well, they sound like they really want to stay in this Premier League. Yeah, they're prepared to spend to
squad girth. Yeah. Squad girth.
Well, it's Dings. Sorry, that's we should probably elaborate on that. Daniel John Ings, Emi Buendia, and Leon Bailey all confirmed in. For about 30 million apiece. And the question is, does that mean that they are supporting Grealish? Or are they the ones coming in for the money that they know is also coming in from the Grealish sale?
Yeah, well, I think they're expected to make about 100 mil from Grealish. So, I mean, that would work. But if they actually manage to keep Grealish, that is a crazy team.
Well, that's the thing. Villa's owners are more stacked in cash than we realise, than we know, than is talked about in the mainstream press. You know, we talk about cities, we talk about Chelsea's, but Villa have rich owners.
Yeah, and they're a club without debt too. They don't, like, yeah. You know, when you look at the big clubs, they all have big debt.
Yeah,
Villa don't have big debt, so it means their spending is... like, validated. It's, they're running a tight ship, a smart ship, and know what they need to do to keep the club above, in the black, essentially, rather than in the red. So
Well, they seem to be managing that really well. And, you know, they've been performing really good since they got promoted.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, look, being... I'm not going to say that I've supported Aston Villa, but I'm from the West Midlands, and these, you know, I've got plenty of Villa supporting mates, and they're having a wonderful time over there. You know, to be relegated, come straight back up, and basically be awesome is something that nearly no team does, and they're in the middle of doing it. It's fantastic to see.
Yeah. Well, I think it's cool that, like, they're getting enough prestige where they literally are stealing transfers from Arsenal. From, well, they stole Buendia. Basically, Buendia chose them over Arsenal. And then, you know, Danny Ings was kind of linked to Spurs linked and to all Spurs. The other teams.
He was linked with Man City as well.
And he's like, nah, Villa sounds like a better choice for me. And then now they got Leon Bailey, who's been linked with various Premier League clubs over the years.
Bailey's been linked with, like, every top Premier League team for, like, the last 2 years.
Yeah, they are building a decent team. Makes the question of if they don't perform, is there a question over coaching at the end of the season? Is, like, Dean Smith, he's, you know, pressure's on him to make these guys play good football and get European results out of it, because that's what they're aiming for. These signings are there to get them European football.
Yeah, they want that Conference League spot.
They can have it.
Well, I suppose that's one possible problem, though, is that if they lose Grealish, that's losing a player like that is kind of one where there'll be a massive hole in the squad, because he runs that shit, you know? So... yeah. If they do lose Grealish, it could actually be, they could turn really bad. It's a big thing to have to adjust for.
Yeah, they could, and with a coach like Dean Smith not hugely experienced in the Premier League. And okay, so the talent that they've brought in with the money that's supposedly from his sale, or hypothetically from his sale, you know, good signings, three good signings right there that we've named. But, like, can you get out of them what you got out of Grealish? Like, the team is not going to the team is not going to play in the same way. You lose your best player, and you're going to have to do something differently.
Yeah, and you have to adapt to three other players.
Yeah.
So instead of accommodating one, you're accommodating three. So how do they play that? Are they going to look at a front two with Ollie Watkins and Dings? Is Watkins going to move wide? There's plenty of options there for them to work it out. If Grealish isn't there, where does he play? Does he play in the hole? Does he play out wide where he likes to be? Mm. So he's got a bit more freedom. So, yeah, but then if he's out wide, is he going to see enough of the ball? There's a lot of questions. But on a whole, it's good news for Villa and Villa fans.
I suppose they're good problems to have, I guess.
Yeah.
The thing too is the other player that they've been linked with is James Ward-Prowse.
Another
player who people, like, big clubs have, like, hummed and hard on, like, I don't know. It's like Villa is willing to take, well, it's not really a risk for them to take. That's just sort of the level that they operate at, right?
Yeah.
So they can snap up all of these players that, you know, people were humming and harring.
Premier League proven players.
And not only that, Southampton to Villa at this stage is
a step up.
Yeah.
It's a horizontal move. Like, it's not quite up, but it's certainly not down.
For sure.
Southampton are a team that, you know, five or six years ago were finishing 6, 7, 8, and now are finishing 13, 14, 15. So their trajectory has been down, and Villa, the opposite. So from Ward-Prowse and Ings's view, fine, go for it. Take a chance on a project, effectively.
Mm. Well, that's the thing. It's all these players that are just sitting in these teams, kind of like, nothing's happening here. They'll see Villa and be like, I should jump on this because this is a chance to either win something or at least improve my value.
Yeah. Chance for a big move.
Well, big move to Villa.
It's the perfect stepping stone. Like, Villa will literally just tack 30 mil on all of these players when they sign to one of the big six teams next season, you know?
Yeah,
well,
that's
Buendia in particular is one who you can see in two seasons leaving to
Arsenal.
I mean, if they're in the top 10, if they're in the top 10 in 2 years, I'll be surprised. But I get what you mean. Like, he's got a big move in him afterwards.
Yeah. Ings probably not. This, I would say, would be his, two seasons at Villa might be the level he gets to in his career. He could be looking at another move to get more game time after this. But, yeah, like you say, a lot of these guys are going to go up and on rather than sit there for 5, 6 years and do nothing. So.
Yeah, you never know. Mm. You never know. I mean, some players... We've seen a whole bunch of strikers, you know, continue going up as they, you know, get into their 30s. And I'm not saying that Ings is on the level of Benzema, Ronaldo and Cavani, but you never know.
Well, I feel like he's sort of just getting into his stride, right?
That's right.
Yeah, so I'm actually hoping he gets even better.
Yeah. Guy I liked at Liverpool, guy I liked before that. And, you know, I hope he's awesome.
Scores goals. Yeah. That's what you want.
And has a fun name.
Yes. Yeah. That's always good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. I am a bit worried about Villa. That's going to be interesting. It's cool. It's cool to see, again, smaller teams in the league get even more difficult. Like, this league gets harder and harder and harder all the time.
Yeah.
And that's why it's the best one.
So, speaking of smaller teams who are getting more difficult, wait for this. This is a flawless segue. Arsenal have have signed, confirmed the signing of Ben White for, yes, I think it's like 55 million euros.
Crazy.
Which good signing.
Good for everyone involved. He probably would have been a better signing for Villa, but he would have slotted into that Villa side very well.
Yeah,
but Arsenal get a quality Premier League proven player that's going to be there for a couple of years.
He's straight into the first team there, man.
Yeah, they need.
He's immediately their best defender.
Yeah, they need good centre backs, and he's a good centre back.
I actually think he's better than good, man. I watched some highlight videos, and he is ridiculous.
Yeah,
he is so calm under pressure for such a young guy.
That's like, great, because Arsenal are always under pressure.
Yeah, he's perfect.
They need two more defenders to go with him.
Mm. Well, I suppose it'd be him and Gabriel will probably be the pair.
They need two more defenders to go with him,
and eight more players who are calm under pressure.
And Kieran Tierney.
New CDM.
So I mean, that's like Ben White, Gabriel, Kieran Tierney. That's a good start, but no right back.
Danny Alves.
No, do they still have Cedric?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's all right. He's there. He's in the squad.
They still have a defender there somewhere.
Well, because I think they're going to lose.
Finally
going to lose. Leave.
Where's it look like he's going?
Inter, isn't it? Inter. From what I, because they've lost
the Premier League reunion team,
because they lost their fullback, didn't they?
But he was out on loan though that season, wasn't he? Hakimi.
Yeah, well, so they still don't have him.
Yeah, but it's not like they're losing something they just had. Well, he was out on loan.
Yes,
like,
they literally lost somebody.
This
so.
Is true, but he was in the squad, and they're going to need to replace.
And they
that
lost Ashley
spot.
Young as well.
Oh, did he retire?
No, he came back to Villa.
He came to Villa, mate. Villa made great signings.
You're right. I forgot about that. Oh, my God. That's amazing.
Look, we could praise Villa for the other three, but I'm not.
I am more than happy to see...
Squad player, man.
To see players that leave a club go on to have a big career and then go back to their original boyhood club or where they made their
made
big
their
impact.
Name.
Yeah. Yeah, big impact. So the Ashley Young move, love it. It's like it's better than anyone going to Derby.
Yeah,
he should have gone to Derby.
Well, that means we just need James Milner back to Leeds. Like that's what we need to see. They'll be gangster.
How dare you?
Well, it would be cool.
He will only go when his contract runs out at Liverpool, which he will just continue signing until he's 40.
Which he'll just train anyway. He won't leave. He'll just be at the training
pitch. No, when he signs for Leeds, he'll run from Liverpool. He won't get a taxi.
On the bus.
No bus. He'll run. And that'll be his pre-season.
So wait, is that all of Villa's signings? Is there any we're forgetting? Is there some other sneaky ones that you haven't seen?
I don't know, and I feel like this is not the time to spring that on me.
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head.
Oh, okay. Well, but, that must be all the good ones then. But
yeah, thoroughly bolstering the front line.
Yeah, and the back line too. With Ashley Old.
Oh, is he going to play centre back?
Yeah. Sorry, we were talking about Arsenal, weren't we? So
Well, I mean, like I say, a calm head on his shoulders. It doesn't even matter if the players are actually good. They need at least four more players like that.
Mm. I think the problem there for a while was the lack of leadership, right?
Yeah, well, like you said, Granit Xhaka's gone.
No, he hasn't yet.
No, he hasn't left, but he's supposed to be leaving.
No, I heard that he is going to re-sign a contract.
Goodness me.
The Roma deal seems to be not happening. Well, it hasn't progressed, so he may stay. But he's... apparently, he's sort of inspired recently. He had the great tournament and things like that, and he's come back and said, this is where I want to play.
What has he got on Mikel Arteta? Does he know some dirt on him?
Well, I don't know. If he can play like anything like he did in that tournament...
He
man,
can't.
We'll see.
Yeah, that's a weird one, isn't it? When you can go away to a whole new team on international duty, in a whole different atmosphere, different tactics, and then you go back to your club, and it's the same old boring shit over and over again. So, like, if he's there for pre-season and he goes, I want to try, and within 3 weeks he realises that everyone's still useless, he's gone. Yeah. He's out. He doesn't care. He'll tell them that he's done. So, yes, it'd be nice for him to stay for the Arsenal fans and for that squad. It would give them a solid platform. Him and Partey in the middle. And then Ben White behind them. It does have a start of a good spine to that team.
It's so funny.
There is talk that Martin Odegaard is going back there on loan, or even being bought by Arsenal. But what I've heard and seen is that there will be a buyback clause, as Madrid love to do. So they are looking to consolidate that team they had last year.
Yeah, that's
they probably need another striker.
If I was an Arsenal fan, that would be my issue.
Well, consolidating an average team.
Yeah,
Odegaard would be a good signing.
Absolutely,
that's a good signing. And then they've got Ben White. That's addressing one of the main problems. And if Granit Xhaka is any better, then cool. But you know, Arsenal is notorious for just breaking players.
I will hold my breath.
Yeah. But what about Aubameyang too? Like, again, Arsenal have all these players. I forget that they have. They have like Aubameyang, like you said, Thomas Partey. I was like, oh yeah. When that move happened, I was so jealous. And then nothing. He did nothing.
Like, we shouldn't be forgetting Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang.
I guess not. Like
top goal scorer in the league, or level top, with two seasons in a row, and then last season. But he scored like 8.
Yeah, but
7.
Didn't his mum was like dying in hospital for the whole year or something.
Look,
like
bro,
that,
I get it.
I'm just saying, like, there's no reason to doubt him. Like, that shit messes you up. He could just come out and be ridiculous again.
So, short of his dad dying of cancer this year, we're expecting another 20 goals.
Totally.
Yeah. He's a 20 goal scorer, isn't he? 20 goals this season. You also have Lacazette, who's another 15 goals, possibly 20 if he gets going.
It seems like even though they didn't overall do great, Lacazette is still a player that's stepped up big time. Like,
he's their number one striker at the moment.
Yeah, Aubameyang was unfit to play, right? And Lacazette was like, alright, I'll have to score all the goals then. And he did.
Yeah. He did.
And Nicola Pepe, looking better all the time, too.
Finally fulfilling some of that potential.
And that happens, man. It takes... It's a very physical league, and sometimes it takes time to adapt. Like, it can take a whole season for some players.
Yeah. I feel like, especially if you were a player like Pepe, where you were sort of silky, you like a lot of skill.
Yeah. You've got to deal with getting hacked down 20 times in a match.
Yeah. Like, now, most of your games are not against, you know, Man City. Most of your games are away. Well, half of your games are away. But a lot of your games are against, you know,
Stoke,
Burnley,
scrappy physical teams.
West Ham, Brighton. Like, teams who are going to kick the nonsense out of you. And you're right, it takes a while to sort it out.
Yeah, you mentioned West Ham there. Just want to move on from West Ham. From the reports, they're looking at Phil Jones.
Like, as a player or as a coach?
Just looking at him. As a model. They're looking at Phil Jones as a possible signing.
Okay. Honestly, I feel like he deserves a fresh chance, like fresh start, rather.
I feel like he doesn't deserve any more chances with United.
I think there's something, like, he is very loved by the club for whatever reason. So that they have, like, an extremely positive relationship. So if he wants to leave...
He does a job. He turns up, he does a job, he goes home. He's not a bad player.
But I think he has a lot of influence, like, behind the scenes. And people have said that he's, like, you know... A commanding presence in the dressing room as well, like that kind of stuff. So
yeah. Well, he's been there a long time. When did he move there? When he was 19, 20?
Yeah.
And what is he now? 29? So he's been there 10 years.
Yeah.
He's been there through the whole change. He played under Ferguson and he's still there now. So he's seen a lot of shit at United.
Well, that's the thing. He'll be one of the few there who will have a league title.
Yeah, him and De Gea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Could you name me another?
No.
Michael Carrick. He's in the staff.
No, he's he's in the staff, not the playing staff.
So I'd be happy if he want, you know, if he's going to move on. That's probably well suited. Why not?
Well, as soon as Varane's in the door, Varane, Maguire, by Lindelof. Like, if that's your four centre backs, that's quite tasty.
God, yeah.
And you don't need Phil Jones. Nah. You've got guys like, well, Twanzebe's a centre back, right? Sort of centre and right.
Yes, plays centre back. However, I have been hearing that he may get a move, be it a loan or sold.
Okay.
We also have Tendon Mengi, who's very near. From what I understand, he's quite near first.
What's that? Chicken tendies.
Yeah. Tendy Mendy. Yeah. So, apparently he's not too far away. So, that's another option.
Yeah, but Wan-Bissaka can tuck in too if you're desperate.
I suppose, yeah, in theory. He is, like, from what I understand, he is rated as the number one one-on-one defender.
Fullback.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I think even defender in the Premier League, at least.
Okay. Either way, they don't need Phil Jones.
No.
That's the core of this. Well,
there may be a big exodus, really. Like, you know, Pereira could go. Phil
Pogba
Jones,
should go.
Dallo, I think Diego Dallo may go.
Ole Gunnar.
Surely not.
Teddy Sheringham still there.
Rashford should go. Sancho should go.
I think the one sort of prominent player who might, maybe Martial.
Yeah,
but
I have heard that.
But I don't know where, and I don't know.
I've even heard Spurs, but
West Ham.
Well, you brought up West Ham, but I did, and I actually would like to talk about them a little bit because last season they were really, really good.
Yeah.
And they haven't made any signings, have they?
They've signed Areola on loan.
Who was out at Fulham last season, wasn't he?
So no.
But who's their goalkeeper normally? Is it Fabianski?
Fabianski.
Good goalkeeper.
Yeah, so they're just adding stock.
Well, I haven't. That's it. They haven't really made any transfers yet, but
they haven't really lost anyone either, though, have they?
Yeah, but if they had added a few more good players like Villa's doing, they'd be a threat as well.
I think Mark Noble retired.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, he doesn't really play though, does he?
I mean,
he's probably too slow for it now.
Well, anyway. Now they've got Suchek, who became like one of the best defensive midfielders in the league last season out of nowhere and scored a ridiculous amount of goals.
He is a frightening man.
Yeah,
just like look at
massive.
His head.
Yeah, he's just huge.
Yeah, they really probably want Lingard back. If they picked up Lingard and Jones, they would be okay again.
Lingard would be good.
Yeah, those two moves. I know it's both from United to West Ham, but.
Why not?
They could happen, and it would be best for everyone. Just look at what Lingard did on loan. Had a stellar second half of the season.
He's amazing.
He's really good.
He's not going to get that sort of quality game at United with their midfield.
He doesn't. They don't select him in that way.
They don't need him, and they're not. If he does play, he'll play wide. He won't play in the team role, which he wants to, and where he's best suited to.
Well, he sort of played like left attacking mid for West Ham, so it's not like a team, but like off the side. So
he still has a chance to influence the central area of the game, which
he sees more of the ball there than what he would at United.
It's not like at West Ham he was a left winger. He was he was central ish.
It was pretty free roam.
All
around that left area.
Yeah.
Yeah, and left center.
And that's the thing. I, like, even if it's at a team that I don't like, and it's maybe a player that I don't like. Not that I don't like Lingard, but I don't like seeing players just sort of
waste away,
sit around,
do
not a lot.
I get what you mean, but someone's got to be on the bench, you know, and not every player is amazing.
No, I agree, but it's sort of weird how, you could build a career by in the eyes of Man United, let's say, being buck average, which is what Phil Jones and Lingard have been for about 5 years.
Well, yeah, I mean, Phil Jones been like pretty much deceased from like what I can remember. So, but Lingard was, you know, a good squad player, and I mean, he moves to West Ham and does some shit, and everyone goes like, he's amazing, but like that could just be a fluke anyway. He's had runs of form like that before.
No, he hasn't.
Yeah, but you don't. No, he has. You don't end up in a United squad if you don't have that talent.
Yeah,
day in, day out on the training field.
He's talented. So
it's not that he's not good enough. It's that he doesn't get the minutes to show it every week.
Yeah.
So well, you don't remember it.
It's our standard is just higher. So
I totally agree. Yeah, which is totally why he should go to West Ham.
Yeah. I'd be fine with that. But
okay, you can sign it off. You heard it here first, Lingard to West Ham.
Yeah, sure, why again.
Not? Why not?
Well, you heard it here first. He was literally there on loan last season.
You going to talk wages or?
No, stop it. Alright, what we did want to talk about from the group chat was sort of, because there's not a lot of football going on, first football memory from... Well, first thing in football you can remember. Just go nuts.
I'll start.
Yep.
My earliest memory of football that I can remember properly would be the 2006 World Cup. I remember this because my family home was being recarpeted. So it just so happened the World Cup was on. We moved all the beds into the lounge and would wake up every morning to watch all the games of football. We'd be up at, I think it was on TV at like 12 o'clock at midnight, and we would get up and watch two or three games of football. Yeah. And that was my memories of like starting to watch football, was that 2006 World Cup, waking up midnight, you know, you'd have breakfast at 1 o'clock in the morning watching football.
Hell yeah.
And you'd watch two or three games. What a great World Cup. Ends with just a barnstorming header into a chest of a man. But yeah, for me, that would be my first real memory of watching football, was that World Cup and watching pretty much every game.
I think that picture, the one with Zidane walking away past the World Cup.
Yeah.
And he's like taking his tape off his wrist. It's got to be one of the most amazing sporting pictures of like photographs I've ever seen. And that game was, I mean, Zidane's one of my favourite players I've ever seen. Like we mentioned in the group chat as well, like player that made you fall in love with football. If it's not Zizou, it's no one. He's amazing. It's like, the guy on FIFA who'd always go, cool, I'm having him, and there we go.
Yeah.
So I'll go next. Mine was that I don't know if I really want to say this, but I'll kind of just go over it. I was 9 years old, so it was 2001, and Liverpool's season, Premier League season, was not going fantastically. I think we finished fourth, but meh. But the FA Cup, League Cup, and as it was known then, UEFA Cup, was going particularly well. In fact, we won all three. But I think my earliest one was driving back from Liverpool to the Midlands with my parents and listening to the penalty shootout in the, I want to say, League Cup final. And just absolutely losing all of my shit. It was, it was amazing. And so, probably shortly after that would have been the 2-2 with Greece, England-Greece, where Beckham scored at the last kick of the game and we qualified first. And again, that was not, like, just rat. We watched in a pub about 20 metres down from where we lived in Shropshire. And just random men who I guess were my dad's mates just like grabbing me and my brother and like throwing us in the air, just singing England songs at the television. It's like this. I was half frightened and half excited.
All I'm picturing is a 10-year-old Paddy being half pissed at a pub, being manhandled by these big burly men, going, "England."
That's exactly right.
Love it. That's what football should be. That should be after every game. All the players should do that.
That's what
go to the pub.
What, throw me in the air?
Yeah, throw you.
Find
around.
Find a 9-year-old.
Yeah, like, throw a 9-year-old around a bit.
We have a tradition. Sounds good to me. Well, I suppose my earliest football memory is probably a bit more recent. I got into this a bit later than you guys. I was sort of vaguely watching football at this point, sort of getting to it when, around the time when like Van Persie signed for Man United and stuff like that. And, well, then it was the, I want to say it was the 2012 World Cup then.
Well, the 2012 was the Euros.
I thought you said 2008. Was that,
so, he said 2006 World Cup.
Oh, so it's 2010.
2010 was in South Africa.
Yeah, so it was a South African World Cup, and that was the. Was that the one when he scored the insane header?
I told you that he'd say that. But that's 2014.
Oh, it is later. I do remember watching the 2010 World Cup, the South African one.
Yeah.
But it wasn't until the next one that one is always the one that stuck in my memory.
The diving header.
Yeah, because I was away like in Dunedin for some drinking trip or something.
Yeah.
For some reason we were there. And it was just on in the morning.
Yeah.
And I just remember watching it and I was like, holy shit, he's literally flying through the air. Like Superman. It was the craziest goal ever. I loved it. And then I saw like just millions of, saw it on TV, like all the highlights of it, like all the time for the next week. It was amazing.
Doesn't it feel a bit weird? It sort of feels like you've got a superpower when you switch the television on and something so weird. I suppose a goal in the football game is not that weird, but so unusual. So,
out of the 90 minutes that you pick that one.
Yeah.
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 But that's probably like one of the earlier ones I have, but for some reason, the strongest memories are always World Cups anyway. For some reason, that's like, though obviously, that's the grand stage.
Yeah, of course.
Because then 4 years later, I so distinctly remember the one with the Germany one. And
that was 2014.
But the.
No, they won and when they beat Brazil and stuff like that.
That was the same World Cup.
That was that one?
That was 2 weeks later.
Gage's mind is what? From 4 years is actually 2 weeks. Is it
and
dog
they played Argentina in the final and Mario goes to score the win. Was it the same one?
2014.
Yeah. 2018, France won it.
Yes.
Dude, it's...
World Cups are fucked anyway,
the game of association football, do that to you.
Oh, so the South African one was 2010.
South Africa was 2010. The final.
Yeah, so that's what I said originally.
Spain-Netherlands.
The final was Spain-Netherlands.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I'm saying. The Van Persie one was 2010.
No, the Van Persie diving header was 2014.
I don't think so.
I'm 100% sure.
No, because I watched it in two different locations.
That's not an excuse.
I was in two places at the same time.
I'm 100% sure.
So it was Van Persie. He was also at home watching it on his TV while flying through the air to score the header.
Because there was the Van Persie goal was in a group game. I think it was 5-1. Spain and Netherlands met in the 2010 final, and Spain won.
Yes.
And then the group game was the rematch. And the Netherlands got their revenge, of course, with Arjen Robben still refusing to pass.
Well then same World Cup then. I still remember watching the Germany Brazil match, which was the
semi
drubbing.
Was it a semi?
It was a semi, wasn't it?
Well, it gave me a semi.
Because I was like at work, I remember this, and I was sort of. I had an app on my phone that was giving me sort of like live updates, and I was just sort of reading it, and I remember seeing like some goals, but you know, it started kicking off, and then it was like, it said like Müller goal, and then like a minute later the same notification came up, and I was like, what the fuck? It's like broken.
Broken.
I was like, it's giving me the same notification twice, and I was like, should I just actually watch this game? And I realized he'd actually just scored two goals within like a minute of each other, and then the goals just kept piling up, piling and piling up. And we me and my German workmate walked to the cafe to get lunch, and the match was on there on this big projector screen, and he was just like, "That's what we do, man."
That's what we do.
It was like what seven? It was like 7-1 at that point or something, and I was like, "Holy shit!"
Yeah, I don't think I've ever been so sure that a team would win a final from a semi-final than after that performance.
Yeah, that, oh.
And they did that whole tournament without Marco Reus.
Yeah,
didn't play. True. Got injured before the tournament. Didn't play.
In that tournament, stat for you, Argentina were behind for 7 minutes, and it was in the final.
Yeah, yeah, that's the only time they were.
That's the only time they were behind in the entire tournament.
Damn. Yeah, and if it wasn't, you know, Mario Götze sold his future bone health to the devil to score the winning goal.
Yeah,
game.
Well, we certainly need to touch on that little trope that we've got in a future podcast, but that's not for now.
Well, why not?
The
main premise is that we just believe when crazy things happen in football is because they sold their soul to the devil.
Yeah, yeah, they went and saw a voodoo doctor did a deal.
Well, I
with
mean,
Harry Redknapp.
You know, the Leicester City win the title. Rennie, and then, yep, and then their chairman gets killed in a helicopter accident.
Wait,
so hang on, who sold their soul? Was it Ranieri or the owner?
No, the owner.
Ranieri did too, and that's why his career changed.
That's why he got sacked.
Did he not die before they won the...
Won the league.
They've won the league, yeah.
Yeah, they won the league.
Before, okay.
Because he bought a bunch of them cars.
Mm.
And you can't do that when you're dead.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, yeah.
No, it was definitely after.
Name the show that. You can't buy a car when you're dead.
Can't buy a man a car when you're dead.
It's all right. Or it's not football related.
Throw a 9-year-old.
Yeah, that's better. There we go, yeah. Throwing 9-year-olds in the air. And yelling, England.
I mean, I don't know about you, but that's my favourite pastime.
So would you say you're the player that made you fall in love with football would be Van Persie, or is there another player that has stood out that you...
Well, I don't know. I was pretty into Messi at that time, obviously. I've seen Messi play a lot, so it was more him that got me into it, I guess.
Okay.
It's hard to go past the best player in the world, isn't it?
Yeah, and Ronaldo, of course, but
yeah,
Messi was probably one of the... just when I saw him, I was like, holy shit.
This guy's like a wizard.
Yeah.
Paddy, for you, player that made you fall in love?
Zidane.
So that,
closer to home, obviously, Steven Gerrard.
Yeah.
Oh, another one for me, though, was probably Robin as well. Just watching him do the same move in every single game, and it always works.
Yeah. No one figure it out. Yeah,
just cuts in from the right, like,
18-yard box, scores
goal. Every single game does the same thing, and no one can stop him. Well,
I liked that the Dutch team had Robin and Robin Van Persie. It just, little things like that in football just make me happy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, my player that I fell in love with would be, like I said, I started watching 2006. 2008, Spurs signed Bale.
Hey.
So, yeah, and then his hat-trick against Inter Milan is something that I won't forget. And also the god that is Jermaine Defoe.
Jermaine Defoe?
Who is just the Spurs legend, so... watching him play from as soon as I started watching football and Spurs, that was something that always watched.
Oh, I got one. And a great memory, not necessarily an early one, but it was when we were all flatting together.
Mm.
And Ash came in and said, "Oh my God, this new guy, Harry Kane's amazing."
Yeah.
He bangs a hat trick and then goes into goal because Lloris gets a red card or something like that.
Yeah, he got sent off.
And then immediately concedes
a shit free kick. It's not a good one either.
And he's even wearing a Lloris kit.
Yeah.
Because obviously they don't have a goalkeeper kit for him.
Well, at that point, I love that happens. It looks weird. Because goalkeepers are actually like bigger and stockier than you.
Yeah, and he was wearing a full-grown man's top.
Yeah.
And he's like an 18-year-old kid. Like, he was a scrawny player when he... Yeah. But how right was I?
Well, you were dead right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so. How little did you know he would become a Manchester City legend in the future?
Look, good on him for 160 mil. Fuck off.
it hasn't happened yet, has it? I mean, if they're going to pay 100 mil for Jack Grealish, are they going to get Harry Kane as well?
Well, they haven't signed anyone else, have they?
They haven't done anything yet.
So City have enough money to buy two big players like that, and it wouldn't surprise you if they went ahead and
got
both.
Terrifying.
Oh. The derby between them and Aston Villa will be terrifying. So.
Yeah, that will be a good game. I'm like...
Yeah, well, it's only about 10 days until the next match. Yeah.
There'll be this podcast, one more, and then...
Then we have some matches about it, yeah.
And we actually have something to talk about.
Yeah, sweet.
So we can... You know, do the 10-year-old throwing podcast next week again, and then talk about some football.
Well, in Gage's mind, that's 2 years' time next week. So
I have no time, guys. I honestly can't.
Time is just a number.
Thing
to
is, by,
me.
By the time we've done the next podcast, the 2034 World Cup might have taken place.
Yeah.
Where will that one be held?
Space.
I was gonna Mars. Say the moon.
Knowing UEFA, it'll be held in like every country in the fucking world, and everyone will have to fly across continents for every match.
It'll take a whole year, and the final will be at the bottom of Mariana's Trench.
Yeah, there'll be a game in your country, but you won't be playing in it. You'll be playing on the other side of the world.
Yeah.
So there'll be a home game, but no one's at home.
Yeah, they'll hold the next Euros in South America or something.
Oh, God.
Don't put it past them.
Exactly, I know. It's terrible.
It is horrendous.
Just a little side note, if anyone had seen it, the USA won the
Gold Cup.
Yeah, seen that.
That was late as well. That was 117th minute or something.
Yeah.
Is it a men's?
That's the that's not the Olympics. That's like their Euros.
Oh, that's right.
America,
North but obviously
American
there's
Cup.
Only like four Six teams in Central America.
Oh, yeah. Sweet.
But the nice thing to see is that because it's so close to the European season, that it's predominantly homegrown players.
Yeah,
it's
cool.
Players that are playing in America,
in MLS or in Mexico.
Yeah, in that area. So. It's good to see them still be able to beat pretty much a full-strength Mexico team without some of these superstars. So
I have heard that the USA is one of the like fastest-growing leagues, and they're producing more quality players all the time.
Yeah.
Well, they have 26 like top-flight teams.
Yeah.
Mainly because they don't get relegated, but they have 20. Yeah. They have 26 teams.
They keep making them, and they don't send them down.
Yeah.
So, I did watch the Olympics game of Mexico and Brazil, and it was just they were just beating each other up the whole time, and it just went all the way to penalties. And of course, Brazil got through there. So Brazil, Spain, for the gold medal.
Nice one. Mm. I of course have to give a little shout out to our own New Zealand All Whites who valiantly battled Japan for a 0-0 and lost on penalties.
Yep. It's not too bad.
Yeah, not bad at all.
And then, have they finished? I think it was Canada. I know Canada eliminated USA.
The final is Canada-Sweden.
Right.
And the third place game is Australia-USA.
Okay.
And I think that'll be soon.
Yeah. Right, so that's just those to go.
Sweet as.
Cool. I have nothing else to add.
Yeah. I'm happy. Just
nothing else. You don't have a game for us this time.
I did not prepare a game.
Oh, that's okay.
Yeah, you're relieved. It's fine.
Yeah, I'm just thinking. Yeah, I'll give Gage's pride a break.
That's fine.
I feel like it's good radio. You know, like every time I just get crushed and defeated.
That's perfectly fine. But what makes it better if there's a punishment involved? Even if it's only drinking a raw egg every time you lose.
A raw egg?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, exactly. Just something.
But
People want, people want to listen to you drinking a Rory.
But I don't have a game.
Can't you just make me run laps, coach? I'd rather do that.
Yeah, you've got to run laps around a Rory and then drink
I'll run laps around Ash.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, we've seen him play before.
That's too far.
If we had video, you guys would get that one.
It's a fat joke.
Come on.
All right, well, I got nothing else. You guys want to cut it there?
I'm absolutely
I have nothing else to say.
All right, well, great. Thanks for listening to another week of Football Friends podcast. We should be back next week with some more football
nonsense
talk. Yeah. But yeah, like and subscribe.
Throw that 9-year-old button in the air.
Throw a 9-year-old in the air when
you subscribe.
Your team wins. That's apparently a thing to do. But yeah. All right. Thanks, guys.
No 9-year-olds were harmed in this making of this podcast.
Car, keep tape.